dice. You never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't go.
Rob, the final version, the final edition of Dungeons & Dragons is coming out. This one, Rob, will be the last one there ever was.
That's right. D&D 1. D&D final. D&D the end. D&D ultimate.
One
D&D to rule them all, Matt. At long last, we've been waiting for this for our entire lives, and they've finally done it. For real, this time. Definitely.
As I think James said on Twitter, it's time for everyone who always belly aches about never having time to learn a new game system. To learn a new game system.
Learn a new game system, yeah.
As they do every 10 years.
So yeah, this is an emergency pod. We are talking about the new, again, D&D 1 playtest materials, which were just released a few days ago. There's just so far character origins, and as you might hear us suggesting, even though this is pitched as kind of a D&D 5.5 D&D update, yeah. I think this already resembles closer to like a, well, I don't know.
Closer to a new edition. They've promised a couple things. So there's an announcement
it's
video
not set
that
in
talked
stone,
about.
So I shouldn't say that until I've seen more, but because right. It's just a play test. But anyway, my initial impressions are
the idea that they promised was that this would be an update to D&D 5th edition that would be more or less backwards compatible, as in like you could use your old adventures or they wouldn't have to republish them with new rules updates. Obviously, like, is that possible? Will that actually be the case? Remains to be seen. Also yeah. promised was, you know, the continued integration of Dungeons & Dragons with its online platforms, along with some previews of a virtual tabletop that uses the Unreal 3D engine, which will suck the graphics power out of my shitty computer, but it looks really nice. Sure it will be a thing. We'll also have to see what happens with that. But anyway, this edition is not going to be released until the year 2024 or so, and so we're promised updates of playtest materials every month or so over the next year and a half. And this is the first one, and it is on backgrounds and character origins.
I think to their credit, WotC has done a good job of incorporating and responding to feedback in the past, and they are soliciting it. So if you don't like what you hear, or if you like what you hear, I encourage you to play test and submit feedback, or just read and submit feedback, because they do respond to it. Remember that in the past, they have changed or left things out, often in my opinion, to the detriment of the game, but, you know, some things from UA's never made it into final books. Rest in peace. What was it? Stone Sorcerer? I really liked that. I wish that hadn't made it to the final playtest. But anyway, they do listen to feedback. They do take these things in consideration. So bear that in mind. What do we have here, Matt?
Yeah, so we have a new sort of way to make your characters sans classes, right? Which is a race, a background, and a feat. Characters get feats at first level. I think the broad thing to say here is that, like, character creation is essentially the same, right? Mm-hmm. We haven't gone to, like, some weird different system. It's very similar to 5th edition. And then the first thing we have to say is that, like, step one, page one, like, I think the, like, barest minimum of stuff we were asking was that don't call the different ancestries, species, lineages in Dungeons & Dragons races, and already kind of put a big divot in the putting green or whatever on this one. Just a big swing and a miss here.
Big whiff right out of the bat. So I don't want to spend too much time on this because many creators smarter than us and more qualified to talk about it have discussed it. But in brief, they have not done away with character races. They have detached ability scores and most things from races, but not entirely. And then they have this really, like, weird, I'm just going to describe it as like a wet fart of a sidebar about children of different humanoid kinds, which
yeah,
it's just like Thanks to the magical workings of the universe, humanoids of different kinds sometimes have children together. For example, folk who have a human parent and an orc parent or an elf parent are particularly common. Many other combinations are possible. Blah, blah, blah. Anyway, it goes on to say, basically, you can pick and choose. You can be a halfling with pointy gnome ears or a elf with gray orc skin. Anyway, it's real, like, bioessentialism. It's weird. I don't know why they thought they needed to include this. It gets into weird, like, blood quantum stuff, or it implies that. Sorry, it doesn't actually get
implies
into it.
Yeah, no, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't like, tell you how to, like, be an elf quadroon or something like that, but
they basically say there's no way mechanically to represent yourself as someone of mixed heritage.
Yeah.
You just pick one, right?
You just pick one.
Which I think, you know, for a lot of people is, like, fairly unsatisfying, especially because I think some worlds, like Eberron, for example, handle quite well the idea that there are entire, like, communities of half-elven people throughout the main continent of Corvair. I don't know. It's just disappointing. It's like, man, people on the DMs Guild, like friend of the show VJ Harris and Adam Hancock with an elf and an orc had a little baby, have, like, done a better job with this.
Yeah.
And yeah, maybe some of the fan rules have, like, more fiddly bits and nuance, which I like, than WotC is ever willing to put in their official rules. Mm-hmm. They're just, they've done a better or more thoughtful job with this. So again, you can't use the word race. Like, just don't do it. Like, you've got ancestry, you've got lineage, species, heritage, parentage, origin. Any of those words would be fine. Like, why did you stick with race? I guess good points on taking off the ability scores from races and some of the things, but, like, eh.
Here's
still
in brief.
Swinging this.
My thoughts on this is, yep, again, Pathfinder does this really well. Not perfectly, but really well. They have a really good approach.
Oh, Pathfinder, you say, 2E. It seems like there are, you know, a fair bit of stuff from there.
We'll get to that. I'm not accusing, again, there's a great deal of intermixing between the editions, so I don't want this to be a Pathfinder, a D&D original war, but
no.
Pathfinder kept a lot of things that were good ideas, and now 5th edition is, like, bringing them back, which we'll talk about in a bit. Anyway, you could do lineage, you could do origin, you could do species, ancestry, whatever. I think it's long past time to do away with the concept of fantasy races. And if you're going to if you must hang on to them, you have to do a better job than this. Hire some people who are mixed race. Hire some more people of color. You will notice the names at the top of this are Jeremy Crawford, Christopher Perkins, and Ray Wininger. So I'm just, you know, this is not it. And I get that. So here's the thing. D&D deserves a little bit of credit for trying to detach itself from a, you know, dubiously, maybe a little racist past and try to appeal to a much more diverse fan base. But this is just not, this is just halfway, you know, either do it or don't do it. Don't, it just feels kind of tokenizing. Anyway, one last thing, and we'll talk about
just
this a
change
bit.
The name. God damn.
Yeah. Just
talking about this for, like, 4 years now, please.
I know this has already been solved in the fan space. This has already been solved in other games. D&D is just, Wizards is just stubbornly refusing to adapt. One thing I will say is that the more I think about this, the more I read, the more I think that you must have, like, real, like, distinct bioessentialist racial differences. Stick with, like, dramatically different races, like dragonborn or lizard folk, or, you know, that are, you know, physiologically, like, not just, and also don't have a weird attachment to certain real world racial and ethnic stereotypes, but even that is imperfect. There are better solutions. That's all I want to say about this. Other people have gone into great detail about why this is either unsatisfying or problematic, so that's all I got to say about that.
I guess into the mechanics, a lot of the same stuff is here, though if you're, like, a dwarf, elf, or gnome, you still choose, like, a lineage, so, like, sub-races have still sneakily survived in that, like, these could easily be decoupled from these names and just been a, you know, pick one of these traits as a gnome. You have the magical ability to speak with animals or to make, you know, I don't know, something, right?
We should mention that all of the flavor and the choices are very planescape, very sigil focused. This is a very planar.
Well, in this announcement, we did get announced we're getting a Planescape campaign setting in the year 2023. So
yes, and of the races, the character origins that were given, one of them is the Ardling.
Yeah, we got a new species here, Ardlings, which are animal-headed celestials, the opposite of tieflings. Uh-huh. And they look like, you know, the kind of celestials that you got in Planescape, right? Where they were like, okay, there's a friendly dog man that is, in fact, an archon of chaotic good. And, you know, this is what they want. And so, yeah, you get an animal head and some wings powers and the opposite of tiefling. You get good spells a couple of times in your character progression.
I don't have strong feelings about this. I'm just curious, do they not like Asimar? I mean, they weren't my favorite race, but, like, is there any particular reason why they had to invent a new one? Are they trying to subvert all the furries by removing Tabaxi and Arakokra and slapping them all under a, you know, animal-headed celestial race? I don't know.
Like it in that I also noticed they added in the sort of variety to tiefling descriptions. In that,
yeah, that's true.
In that it adds, like, I feel like Asimar are just, like, more boring role-playing-wise.
That's true.
In that they're like, oh, you're just a whatever elf, human, dwarf, but more beautiful and perfect. And no, this one, if you want to be a good tiefling, you have like a stork head or something.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny. I also noticed that humans got a free feat at first level. You know, I was like, oh, humans are actually useful to pick in the default rules, at least in this particular playtest. I like that.
Let's jump to backgrounds, right, to talk about feats, to see why, to talk about why this is.
Sure. So I wanted to, before we got into backgrounds, or at least to preface backgrounds, they sort of flipped the background default rules, which I think does a lot. In 5th edition, the player's handbook, you open up, it has like 20 pages on backgrounds and a tiny paragraph at the end that's like, you can build your own background if you want to. At least in this playtest, it says, everyone gets this, you know, two skill proficiencies, a tool proficiency, a language, and, you know, some equipment. Build it to represent your character. Here are some samples, right? And that's a pretty tiny shift, but it, I think, will change the play at most people's table, as most people are like, oh, I will build my own background, right? Mm-hmm.
Basically,
and ability scores are moved here.
So basically, this is the key point: is that you can now, at will, without any twisting or min-maxing, just give your character 1+2 and 1+1, or 3+1s. Basically, 3 free ability scores. You don't have to play a dwarf or an orc or an elf to get the right combination of ability scores. You can do whatever you want. It comes from your background, which is great. Some people fuss that this maybe removes the distinction. I don't feel that's the case. I think this is a good solution. You get to pick skills, tools, language, a feat, and equipment. So this is now all lumped into background, which is, yeah.
2 points on tools and feats. First, the feats that we're given all have a level attached to them. So these are first level feats. Applying, there will be first level feats, fourth level feats, eighth level feats, etc. Also, tool proficiencies have an added core rule to them, which is if you have proficiency in a skill and a tool that apply to an ability check, you get advantage. So that makes them a little more useful.
That seems like a great adjustment. I like that. I have always been confused about how and when to use tools since I started playing 5th edition. I have stubbornly refused to read the rules more than once, so that's on me. But yeah. This is a nice touch.
Again, I like the switch. I like the idea that, you know, most people are just making their own backgrounds. I like the changes. I like everyone gets a feat at first level, and that humans get two, so at least they have something. And I like sign language, for example,
added to the
language. There's, like, you know, some nice little touches.
There's some good things. I really like the feat at first level. This is a house rule that I have been using for like 3 or 4 years. I don't know why Wizards half-assed the feats in the first place. I will never understand it. I never understand why they thought making them an optional rule. honestly, feats are one of the cooler things about D&D. Yeah. One of the things that makes you able to distinguish your character from others. So I think this is a nice touch. I'm glad they gave humans back a free feat.
A free feat in addition to having normal ability score increases. So you're not behind. Here's an interesting thing that I notice in the I'm gonna call them species, but you'll know what I'm talking about. In the species rules and in the feat rules, they're really leaning into what they developed over the last year or two, is that if you one of these features gives an ability, you get to use it a number of times per day per proficiency bonus, which I'm still not convinced works very well, that it I'm not convinced that scales very well. I'm also not convinced that it's easy to track. So I could be proven wrong, especially if it's something that's a little more default into the core rules. I find it a little more fiddly.
I liked it better. Yeah. I understand why they changed it, but I just in terms of ease of tracking and just simplicity, I liked it better when most things refreshed, if they refreshed at all, on a short rest or a long rest. You know,
you're a dwarf wizard with the lucky feat. You now have, you have the arcane at level 2, so early in the game, you have arcane recovery to keep track of, you have your spells to keep track of, you have your uses of lucky to keep track of, and you have your uses of tremor sense to keep track of, right? Yeah. I just wish some of these could be rewritten as a thing that you could just like kind of have or don't have that applies in these situations. I don't know. Maybe it is more fun to have this stuff to keep track of. We shall find out.
In addition to all of that, to the feats, there are some new rules or some.
Didn't change the name of Savage Attacker. I remember we talked about this we're talking about this again in Tasha's. Yeah, Jesus. Okay. There are lots of new rules.
Here's another thing you could word of advice. You just don't need it. The word savage. You don't need to have that anywhere. Anyway, there are some new rules, and as we hinted at before, there's now three types of spells or magical abilities.
Right. They're spell lists. Arcane, divine, primal. Where have we seen these before?
Well, we've seen these in 4th edition, and we've also seen them in 2E. Pathfinder. And it seems like quietly 5th edition Wizards is acknowledging that there were some good things about 4th edition and some good ideas from Pathfinder, and they are bringing them back or stealing them, however you want to frame that. I always liked this distinction. I don't know how important it is, but I always found it kind of pleasant having druids and rangers and other natural spellcasters have their own distinct pool of primal or natural magic to draw from. So this is fun for me. I like this. I thought this is a nice touch.
I wish they went full Pathfinder 2E and let bards pick any of them, right? Because that's what bards can do in Pathfinder 2E. Yep. They're like, oh, you get all of them.
Yep.
Your magic is weird. Anyway, I like the spell list. It'll simplify some things. I like the world building implications of it. At the end of the day, it's not that important. It will save some space in further expansions and rulebooks. We're also introduced to, I think, two other fairly important tweaks to universal rules, which is there's common language about ability checks or maybe attack rolls. They're often just referred to as tests. Which brings up that if you roll a natural 1 on any test, including an ability check, it is a failure. If you roll a natural 20 on any ability check, it is a success, which slightly differs from 5th edition as it is now, where that usually only applies to attack rolls and maybe saving throws. I find that this is a rule that people in 5th edition get wrong a lot of the time, right? People are like, oh, I rolled a 1 on this ability check. And you're like, you know, you have like a +9 on this. It's still a 10. You were just hopping a fence in a dramatic moment.
Like, right.
You didn't.
So
what are your thoughts on this?
I don't like it. I'm sorry to be a grognard about this.
Yeah.
But like, as we are just now discussing, you know, this means that every time you call for a roll, and maybe this is a good thing, but you need a
5% chance of failure.
Yeah. And it punishes It punishes anybody who has to roll more often than people who don't. And, you know, certain classes, certain types of characters are more likely to cause others to roll rather than do the rolling themselves. I also...
We shall see if there is a change. There was a hint that there would maybe be a change on that. Like for spells? I don't know if this is true, but maybe there was a hint that all spells will have a spell roll instead of a enemy save. I got that in the video. I don't know if that will be the case.
I would support that. Anyway, I understand this can be fun and exciting, but like I'm already like imagining a... I don't know. Maybe this is like, but like a barbarian being like, I pick the lock, and, you know, rolling a natural 20 and picking the lock, or, you know, a frail wizard halfling saying, I bend the bars, you know, of this iron cage, and they roll a natural 20. And then you as the DM are tasked with, you know, either maintaining verisimilitude or somehow making that make sense. And that just, it feels like it places pressure on the DM. And specifically, this works in other systems better, having successes like this or failures like this. I don't think it works particularly well in D&D, even if it is fun.
The flat D20 roll as opposed to like a normalized curve.
Yes, exactly.
Here's the thing is, I think this might actually be a good change to simplify the rules, in that you have this common rules. 20 wins, one loses. In between, you got to figure out and compare to the DC. But if it could also be included with some language for dungeon masters that is better than what is in the player's edition about when to call for a roll, so that if your frail halfling wizard says, I try to bend the steel bars, and your dungeon master says, your strength is 8. This is not a task that is possible for you.
Well, and that's the thing that I'm imagining is a problem, because if again, as a DM, you can say...
That's the real problem, in my opinion.
You can say, no, you can't do that, but then your players are going to get mad, because they're used to being able to like at least make a roll on anything that they want to. And if you let them make a roll on anything they want to, then you are going to increasingly have to, you know, adjudicate. They're going to roll on everything, because if they get a natural 20, they're going to be like, I try to charm the king into giving us his pants. And, you know, you have to be like, no, you can't do that. And they're like, well, I want to. I'm going to roll it. Anyway, sorry. I'm already imagining.
It's fine.
I'm already imagining how this is going to be a disaster for certain groups.
Again, I think it could be a good change if there was better rules on how to call for rolls and adjudicate them.
Matt is correct, though, that this is one of the most misunderstood rules in the game, and so maybe this
Just going with the misunderstanding at the
right
end of the
time. Right. So maybe that's exactly right. So we're just encoding the misunderstanding rather than trying to fix it. Anyway, I've already expressed my reservations about this, though. but maybe depending on your group, it'll be fine. There is one other thing.
The last thing I wanted to bring up is probably the same thing as you, right? Which is one of 5e's most overlooked and unuseful things, which is inspiration. Looks like it has been coded into... Okay. All right. You do yours.
No, you do inspiration, because that's the more important thing.
So, there's an inspiration rework. So inspiration 5th edition is not really in the core rules. It is like a thing that dungeon masters can give out. Players can only have one source of inspiration at a time. They often hoard it or never use it. Inspiration is like awarded by several features, including one standard to human beings as a species, that they start the adventuring day with inspiration. The rules are you can still only have one instance of inspiration if you have, which will let you gain advantage on any check. But if you have inspiration and you gain inspiration again from something that happens, you give inspiration to someone who doesn't have it in your party. The other core thing is that whenever you roll a natural 20 on any check, you gain inspiration. This is their hero point Benny system for one D&D. What do we think of it?
I really like, in general, hero points, action points, Bennies, whatever. I think that they are a great tool for any gaming system, and I've always kind of been annoyed that D&D doesn't have a good one. I've always liked inspiration in general. I know that not everybody loves it, but I think it's fun. I give it out pretty generously at my tables just for good role play or doing cool things. So I like this in general. I like giving people more inspiration. It encourages them to use it. It gives them a chance to like succeed on their important roles. I do want to again point out that this further encodes the
role for everything.
Role for everything.
Make
players
as many
are
roles
going to be
as
making
possible.
As many roles as they can conceivably fit into the game. I don't want to talk about this too much more because I've made my point on it, but like, why would your players not roll every single moment that they can? This is going to induce so much rolling at your table unless right. you like, and that's going to make you have to be the unfun DM and be like, no, we're not stopping so that you can roll to try to barter with this shopkeeper. No, you don't get to make a perception check. Like, no, you don't get to try to pick the lock on this. Like, I'm already seeing issues with this, but in general, I want to say I love inspiration as an idea. I think it is a pretty good mechanic, and I like that they're giving more sources of it and trying to make it more central to the game.
Yeah, I think this one is a nice stab at an inspiration rework, but Rob has pointed out its fundamental flaw, which is it encourages a sort of perverse form of approach to the game, which is the more rolls I make, if I don't have the more inspiration I can give to the party for later. Is this the worst Benny or hero point system we've seen? No, that's still got to go to Kids on Bikes.
Yes,
but
that's right.
That it's not. It is by no means the best.
It's on the lower end for sure. It's definitely, yeah.
When I was like thinking, oh, when you roll and you get a natural 20, you get inspiration. Like, that actually seems the opposite of the way it should be. Shouldn't you get inspiration when you roll a 1? As like a nice, you failed this check, since you automatically fail. You failed this check, which may be one that your character should normally succeed on. You're a wizard and you make a arcana check about some lore you should know. You roll a 1, but you gain inspiration. It's a thought that's percolating in your mind about something that will tangentially come up later. You know? It would make more sense if you get it on a 1 as opposed to a 20. Like, a 20's already great.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't know. Because lots of systems we've looked at, you gain inspiration when you fuck up, when you fail, or when you intentionally fuck up, right?
Yeah. There's more here, but there's one last thing that I want to point out, which surely cannot make it into the final version, which is unarmed strike. So they've complicated the language around unarmed strike.
This is a feat.
Which is a no.
A part of a feat.
No.
A part of the tab.
No. This is just a new rule, Matt. This is under rules glossary.
Oh, yes. Okay, right.
So there is a tavern brawler feat, which now improves your unarmed strike. But listen to this. Unarmed strike is a melee attack that involves using your body to damage, grapple, or shove a target within your reach. Your bonus to hit is your strength plus proficiency, blah, blah, blah. On a hit, your unarmed strike causes one of the following effects. You can do damage, which at base is just 1 plus strength. You can grapple, or you can shove, push the target 5 feet away, or knock the target prone. Now, Matt, are you seeing the problem here?
You can, on a hit, knock any target prone?
Knock any target, not more than one size larger than you, but still, any target. If you hit, you just knock them down, no matter what. Like, they don't get a save. All you have to do is hit. I know prone is not as powerful as it was in previous editions, but that seems kind of insane to me. That seems totally abusable in about a dozen different ways, because all you have to do is be able to hit, and you can either shove a target or knock them on their butts.
Is this okay? Is this how is this different than then the unarmed strike of our current edition? Is it really they just added the
grapple and
part?
Shove is right. I should confirm that, but I don't believe.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I think that's the difference, is that in the current edition, you just had the first bullet point, which is
you can
do damage, but you can't do the grapple or shove,
so the grapple and shove is
explained
new.
In another set of rules, right? In current edition, shoving a creature was a special melee attack.
Yes.
Which you made a strength athletics text.
Yes.
Check against a target strength or dexterity check.
Yes.
So
that was a skill challenge, right? And right. There were problems with that too, but it was much harder to pull off, and the risk reward
ratio
was
much more random to pull off.
Yes.
Because it was a d20 roll off.
But
right?
But it is much it's just like much, much more consistent if you build your character to hit things, to be able to hit consistently with an unarmed strike.
Yeah.
You know, which is cool. And also, by the way, I want to be clear. I love shoves, grapples, bull rushes. I this is one of my favorite parts of playing a martial character, but it is usually difficult to do. And this is something that you do kind of need, I think, a few more rules around, because otherwise you're just knocking people on their ass all day long, which in previous editions you could build really broken characters to do, which was fun. But like D&D correctly recognized this was an issue if you had a, you know, chain flail using half orc fighter who could retreat every round and trip and always succeed. You know, again, I don't know if you're old like us, you remember this shit, but now it seems like if you want to build a monk with high dexterity and easy ways to get advantage, you can just knock every foe prone every round as often as you feel like.
Yeah, it's... Sorry, my cat is moving my...
Do you need to do something about your cat?
Yeah. it's just moving my camera. Yeah, I don't know. So mechanically, Rob, I will point out that this is not that big of a change from our current set of rules. But, you know, thematically, like the way people play, putting the rules like this might make this type of play more common. Pathfinder 2nd edition, again, like, or at least even 1st edition, solved this problem by giving every monster a second AC.
Well, right.
Which is their AC against shoves.
This was not the right solution either, but like, it, you know, I don't know. It should be based on size and strength score or something like that. I don't know. Anyway, this just seems abusable to me. Let's wrap this up.
I would this could be easy fix, which is shove, instead of your against the target's AC, it's against the target's strength score or dexterity score, whichever is higher.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that. Yeah, that might be a good solution.
That seems like an easy fix to me too.
Anyway, well, so there is one D&D. It's coming down the pike. You can't escape it. It will cover all the lands in a second darkness, Rob.
That's right.
Again. It really sucks because I think I would be pretty excited about all of these minor fixes. I'm like, okay, it's not a new edition. A lot of things are fixed up, other than like just the like one thing I think people were asking for, which is call races by a different name.
Yeah.
Like they did not make that change. So, you know.
Yeah. We'll see. Again, this is just a playtest. There are some things I'm interested in, but generally it's fine. We'll see.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, everyone. New edition of D&D. It's fine.
It's fine. Stay tuned for further updates.
All right. Thanks for listening to this emergency bonus episode of Dungeon Master of None.
That's right.
You know, if you have thoughts on this or, you know, want some game advice, drop us an email at dmofnone@gmail.com. You can always join our Discord if you want some advice from some other lovely dungeon masters that are not Rob and I. Or you can, if you want to hear more of the show, you can support us on Patreon.
Thanks, everybody. And keep rolling them dice.
One is the loneliest number that you'll ever do. Two can be as bad as one. It's the loneliest number since the number one.